All right, I thought it was high time that we did another block-in video because I think it's been many weeks since I did a block-in video, and it's always really good exercise and it's good for me to keep doing them often, and it's, I think, a good idea to always keep a new block-in video going here on Patreon so they don't get too buried down below in the timeline. So let's do a straightforward block-in. I picked for a reference, I found an old image in the archives that has a nice tilt to the head, you can see here, and the relationship between the head tilting and the body, I think, is really interesting, challenging, and also the profile has some really great shapes. So I think it's a good one for you all to follow along with if you're interested, or you can just take these ideas and apply them to your own live model or reference, because these same concepts apply either way, photo reference, live model, this stuff is applicable across the board. So one thing you'll just notice, I want to make sure you have a sense of what these marks are, if you can see them. I'm not sure yet. They are, I think, in view frame. Those are just me marking the paper so I know what's within the camera. I wanted to say that so that you didn't think there was some sort of pre-measured thing that you should be doing to follow along. It's just so I know, stay inside of this area, and that's all there is to it. Outside of that, I'm just going to start the drawing. I have a... Oh, this is Artist Loft. I believe that just comes from Michael's Arts and Crafts. I think so. Am I right on that? We'll just go to Michael's Arts and Crafts. I used to go to AC Moore, but I think they closed or were bought out by Michael's. I'm not 100% sure. But yeah, just a regular art pencil. This is an HB. I'm only going to use an HB for this block-in. And I got a kneaded eraser, and this is a Strathmore drawing pad clipped in onto a drawing board on a vertical easel. So things are upright in front of me, and I have the reference right off to the right here because I'm left-handed. I like to look off this way. If you're right-handed, you might want to look off in the opposite direction. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. Let's make this about a 40-minute block-in, and let's see how it goes. If it turns out okay and isn't horrible, maybe we'll take this one, finish it, and maybe do a toned drawing this time, since the last figure drawing I did is now in development as a painting. So let's just play it by ear and see how it goes. Okay. So I'm going to start a tilt at the top of the head, and this is going from one piece of hair to the next right above the face. And then I'm going to go like this, and this is just a tilt from the top part of that hair to sort of the back of the hair. Hold up a pencil, the image, or if you're working from a live model, and just follow those tilts around. All right, so you got a nice big sequence there. I don't take it too seriously at this point. Don't worry too much if this is so abstract that it's really hard for you to sort of see what's developing. I get it. I kind of still feel that way about this stage of the drawing, you know? I have confidence that it'll pull together, so I'm not worried about it. I used to be kind of worried. But this doesn't feel like much of anything, so just get something going, you know? Low stakes right here. These lines, I'm holding the pencil like a brush, meaning the graphite doesn't go on very hard. I'm not, you know, etching it in at this point. So stay loose, stay broad, and stay relaxed, and that's all that really matters at this point. Sweeping tilt under the chin. Now look at where the neck tilts up. If you were to follow the neck, where would it intersect the face? If I hold a pencil up to check, it would come right above the nose. Now I don't know where the nose is, but I made a little break right there where I went from the top part of the face to the lower part, and the neck kind of intersects just above that, just enough to get something down. Tilt from the chin to the shoulder is like right about here. I'm not going to draw that line because I don't want to, you know, make too much stuff on the paper. I want to keep things relatively clean at this point. Oh, there I go. And I just drew it. Nice. And a tilt from the trapezius area to the tip of the shoulder, something like this. Okay. There we go. Now, let's go ahead and just, the thing I want to do right now, just to make myself less confused looking at this, is subdivide or separate the hair shape from the face and neck and shoulder shape. So let's go ahead right now and just cut right in here. And there is the hairline, tilt of this part of the hair. Keeping it very simple, not following the curls in and out or the curve out here, just tilt. Simple tilt. Okay, good. So now let's go ahead and include some more dominant stuff on the interior. I want to do this really vivid cast shadow. There's a weird double light going on. You can see a cast shadow from the ear here that is getting a lot of light in it. So let's just go ahead and make do and kind of simplify as much as we can. A little bit too much going on there lighting wise, so we'll try to reduce the complexity. But I'm going to add this dominant shadow right here, like so. Kind of indicate where this shadow on the cheek is. What I did right there was I followed through on this to kind of see how this related, and it's just into the right where the far eyebrow is. Because what I'm setting up to do here, the thing that for me will start to move things forward and start to make this feel more like a face is, of course, the features. And there's nothing better than the sort of graphic contour that you get when you have a profile or very near profile. I guess you could go ahead and say this is a profile. I said very near because you can slightly see that far eye. But nevertheless, we get a very compelling shape here. And I wanted to lay some groundwork, but moving into that contour sooner than later, I think is a smart idea. So I'm gonna just erase back a little bit. I can still see the lines there. I'm not positive that shows up on camera, but I can still see them. And so now I kind of wanted to lock into this and kind of interrelate it down here so that from here I can then just tilt my way down the contour. Now I'm going to keep it very, very simple. I'm just guessing the length of the nose. I don't have a solid answer on that yet. So notice this. This is that triangulation idea. So I went here like this. Let me back up a little bit. I tilted this from here to here. I didn't know how long the nose was, but I kind of looked at a tilt really quick between there and the chin, right? So that sort of tells me that you need to get this angle right here correct. I need to stop the nose right about there. If I made the nose out here, then this tilt would be different. If I stop the nose too soon, the tilt would be more like this. So to get this tilt right, with this means the nose ends right there. Now, again, I don't feel like this is 100% accurate, of course. I think it's very likely that'll change, but I'm doing the same thing here. How long does this tilt go? I'm looking at this tilt individually, and then where does it tilt into the sort of middle part between the two lips? And I can take this and look at the tilt there between the nose and that, and it gets me right here. Okay. Just a little subdivision right there. The sternocleidomastoid's coming around. That's the muscle from behind the ear down to the pit of the neck. And something I want to do in this, by the way, is I want to do some compare. I don't tend to measure as much as I maybe should, both from the point of view of making my drawings better, but also from the, tutorial point of view where I should be showing more measuring. I had some questions recently from someone. I'm so sorry. I can't remember who asked, but somebody was asking me about comparative measurements recently. And I wanted to sort of take some time in this video to show a little bit more of that in action so that... you can have that tool more at your disposal as you work. But right now, I think it's a little bit early for measurements. I would encourage you to sort of forego that for a moment until you get a little bit more in. Basically, you want some stuff in that you can measure. I think measuring hypothetical points in empty fields of shapes is not the best plan. All right, so now I'm tilting off here and I'm sort of looking at this relationship here to kind of figure out what the tilt should be of this off of this. And they sort of make a wedge shape or V shape together. And so I'm sort of assessing that in relationship to one another. And then I'm tilting here. And I'm trying to see where on the forehead this would intersect if I ran this tilt up. And then if I took the tilt of the, if I go like this is the front of the eyelid right there, intersects if I run it down more towards the mouth, and that kept me from having it too low. So that's interesting because my impulse was off there. Okay, so there you go. That's all right. Feeling a little bit better, more sort of grounded in this right now. Okay, let's see how this plays out. So here's a little tip. This is really helpful. You can do this at all stages of the drawing. Is you can count your way from here to the wing of the nostril. This is one of those spaces that, you know, is so commonly off in my own work, and I discover it later on when I'm painting. Sometimes I don't even catch it in the drawing, which is always not good. But I see it when I critique a lot. I always see that space being questionable. So very often it's too tall. Like the space from here to here gets elongated, eyes are too far up, nose is too long, but it can also easily get crunched. So basically I go from about right here and I kind of count my way through all the things that have to happen, right? So if I were to have the eye here and then there's a space here for this cast shadow, going down to the crease here, which is the sort of zygomatic cheekbone, then the levator labii, this form here, it's usually not nearly as big as we sometimes treat it, because sometimes we draw this and then we teleport down here and we don't intimately account for that space. So if I go from here to here, the nasolabial fold is not that far away. Like it's a space that's about this proportion in relationship to the whole thing. Now you don't want to get too detailed at the same time. So with great economy, you want to sort of betray these marks. And let that feed into this shadow shape right here. Okay, not bad. All right, so let's just continue on and just sort of see where this takes us. Let's draw this shape right here. You can see it in a very abstract way. Like you could look at it as like tilt, 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 tilt right in here. So if I look at this in the sort of wedge shape or angle, this comes to that lip right there. See, I'm running that up to see where the corner of the mouth would be if I took that up and where it would intersect with the nose, so I don't end up way over here. Because if it was over here, it would intersect the nostril right there. But I look at this relationship right there. Now, something that's happening, and I'm aware of this, is that this happens so often, I'm gonna let it happen because I don't care in this drawing. There are situations where I do care, but I'm gonna tell you exactly what's happening. Things are contracting here. I know this must happen to all of you because I see it all the time when I work with artists on drawings. I have it happen all the time to this day. And it depends on what I'm working on, what the project is, whether or not I'll let it happen. And our scale, when we lock into an area, can often change. Now, if I were doing more of the figure, I'm doing the figure up to here. This is not that much. So the priority is this. And for efficiency's sake, I'm going to keep this the priority and let other things adapt to it. So if this contracts, I have to be aware of it. Being aware of it is very important. And then knowing what I have to do, or, you know, working towards solutions that adapt everything to this. If I was doing more of the figure, if I was doing down to, say, the navel, or certainly the waist and the whole figure, I would not be locking into this as early, and I would be sort of what you saw in the last series of block-ins, which was more of the figure. I locked into the torso, the peanut shape of the rib cage to the pelvis, right, the sort of the core. That was what I locked into, and then the face had to adapt to that because there were, you know, bigger fish to fry in that scenario. In this instance, I would still categorize this mostly as a portrait, and so I'm willing to do that. So right now we're gonna proceed with this, plant a little red flag there, knowing that this stuff might have to adjust in relationship to that. There's also, you know, the angle here, like this is one thing, but there's also a sense that the head is tilting more towards us. Like if there was a pull coming out of the head, an axis, that it's more like this. I've flattened it right now to where I feel like the head, instead of being like this in space, is like this in mine. So I'm aware of that as well. Too early for me to get too worried about that, but I don't mind taking a sort of calm, patient inventory of issues like that. The tilt of this to the tilt of the bottom of the ear here is actually really shows you how low that ear is. It's pretty incredible how low it is. And I don't want to get too crazy with that right now, so let's just kind of mildly indicate that. This is a confusing area. I don't know what, it looks like the hair is actually way back here, and then this is shadow, but then that double light shadow. So yikes, let's just keep it simple. And then let's look at space here. So we did that right here where you're like space, right? Let's look at this. Space here, that seems pretty reasonable. And then this to that next crease right here is really can't be bigger than that because this distance isn't much bigger than this, right? And so if I'm counting through space in this very sequential way, I want this crease to be here. And sure enough, that asks us to raise the body here. Let's see where this most salient sort of point is. If I run a vertical line up, I'm basically going up like this. Gets me just on the outside of the chin, which means right there. And let's do a tilt from here to here again. Right? Wow. I'm just so right on, it's scary. No, I'm kidding. But yeah, it actually is pretty close there, but it did have to go up quite a bit. I mean, that's a pretty substantial move for the overall scale of the drawing. I'm not gonna go crazy on hair right now, but I'm going to just make the shape a little bit more particular. We are moments away from my absolute favorite part of the drawing. Should be everyone's favorite. And that is, we are going to erase everything. Roll it up, go over it. The point to do this is when you have everything sort of in, and take it to about this level right here, keep the drawing nice and clean, and you can still see everything. That's the key. Still see everything. We have a nice fresh start, and that's after you kind of lay everything in, go back through it, and kind of codify the relationships a little bit, and now you can see it more. So let's go ahead and do what I promised, and let's do some comparative measuring. So I think we're about 17 minutes in, so let's see where we're at with everything. So let's take, oh gosh, I don't know, let's take the height of the head from right here at this point up to here, so the vertical height of the head, which we have to adapt to the tilt here, and let's compare it to the width. So I'm going to measure this right here from the reference, and then I'm going to compare it to here. Okay, now, one word here. I always suggest measuring as though you're working from life, because I think that you want to, you know, have tools that will allow you to step in front of a live model, in front of an art group, or if you hire your own model or whatever you do, you take a workshop. You want to have tools for drawing and measuring that adapt to that scenario. If you take too full advantage of the fact that you're working from a flat reference and actually measure on the flat reference, then that's not going to translate as well in the model room. You're not going to be able to do that. So I suggest honing your skills in the more difficult way. It's more challenging to sit there and have your arm out. And what I do is I put my arm out and I put my thumb on the bottom part of what I'm measuring, and then I put the tip of my pencil on the other thing I'm measuring, and then I compare it like this, and I go through it over and over and over again, because you know there is a certain margin of error when you measure like that, because your hand shakes, your eyes don't know what to focus on, your hand moves without you realizing it. So you take the measurement, you know, four or five times, and then you get this sort of average results from that. So I recommend doing that. So I'm holding my pencil out right now, looking at the reference, which is quite a bit away from me to simulate me working from life. And I'm putting my thumb on the bottom here like this, and then I'm lining up the tip of the pencil to the point I want to measure, and then I rotate my hand and I see how that compares to this. And I'll tell you what results I'm getting in a moment. Close one eye when you do this so you don't have, you know, binocular vision will distort things, make it hard to get an accurate measurement. So I'll tell you what I'm measuring first so that I can't ruin it. I'm getting that this right here should be about from here to almost there on the ear, which makes it a tough measurement because how much do I trust that, right? But it'll give me something at least to go on. Why? How? Just amazing. All right, that's pretty good. All right, let's do something a little bit finer than that. I'm gonna measure from here to about right there and then do the same thing and see how far across that gets me on the face. So I'm holding my pencil up against the reference, lining my thumb up with the bottom of the chin, closing one eye, and then trying to get the point to line up just to the eyelashes there. And then I'm gonna rotate it that way. Ooh, my hand is wobbly. Okay, so there's the eyelashes in there and there's this half tone right there. And so I would say that this is supposed to equal to about right here. I'm gonna put the mark down. That's where it should roughly equal. Let's see how I'm doing on that. Okay, let me measure that again. I don't wanna believe I'm that wrong. There's no way. Okay, I swear I'm not making this up. Let me measure this again, because this is gonna just be too convenient. All right, I'm getting a further distance right here now this time. Okay. Close enough is my analysis here. I'm looking for like wildly off, and it's within a range right there. I'm gonna kind of put a little bit of a sort of mental notation there to be like, I'm not totally secure on that, but between this one and that being within the range there, I'm not 100%. I feel like it's good enough to proceed. So let's go ahead and move forward. Press this back a little bit more. I want to use a little bit more tone here because, to be honest, I find I don't want to model in the lights, but using a little bit more tone for shape drawing can really help some people. It helps me. And so I think I've been keeping things really linear lately. So let's do a little bit more tonal work here with these shapes. I'm keeping it really light, but let's really kind of make this shape, you know, fill it in really lightly. Everything can be erased. Oh, you know what I want to do? I'm going to put this. I put a pencil extender on. Okay, very good. Let's keep things very, very connected, meaning I'm gonna not jump over too far to another form far away. I'm gonna just immediately sort of negotiate that space right there, which can kind of nudge in a little bit to not be so far from that. Coordinating now, same concept, but instead of like going and seeing to the tilt there, I'm gonna look for the tilt that points to this point where then there's a break in the nose contour. I feel like the humidity must be really high right now because this paper is feeling. You ever notice that when your paper, what's really humid and your paper almost feels spongy or something? I like the more arid days where the paper feels very crisp. I don't know, do you guys ever notice that? I mean, I notice humidity changes when it comes to paint, but do you ever notice it with paper? I think it's really weird. Okay. I have a certain anxiety about the nose being a little long, but I don't want to get too wrapped up in that right now. Now, this idea of this face and the head tilting out like this to where the top of the head rotates towards us and the chin away, I want to start thinking about that somewhat conceptually. I'm not going to force it yet because I don't want to start superimposing things I don't actually see based on that concept, but I'm alerted to that fact, and I'm realizing that there may be certain things I could conceptually identify that would help convey that. So let's keep an open mind to that as we move forward here. So part of it, I think, is the scale of this stuff just got a little bit too big. So the lower half needs to get a little smaller to rotate around there in space. Yeah, very good. You know what? Let me zoom in the camera so you guys can see this a little bit better, okay? And we'll come back out to the rest of the body here in a little bit. I even think this can get a little smaller. And the way some of this stuff here is shaped, if it's more curved, that would be like we're looking more down on the head, which would make it rotate like that. If it, the more it was tilted and sort of flat from our vantage point, the flatter these shadow shapes would be. The more it rotates towards us, the top of the head, the more those would be curved. It would be like seeing a sphere. And if the sphere was sort of had flat in relationship to the light source, the shadow edge would be more like this. and the more the sphere rotated towards us in relationship to the light, which I know that makes it sort of a confusing way to put it, the more this shadow would be curved like this, rotated on its axis. And so I think that's part of it. Some of these interior things, the more this is sort of curved right here, this halftone or dark light. Oh, wow. All right. This is going to go longer. Why do I keep telling you all in the beginning how long the video is going to be when I don't actually know? I should stop doing that. Try to keep it still relatively short, but I don't think it's going to be 40 minutes anymore because I'm having way too much fun. I can't stop in 7 minutes. It's not possible. There's no way. We're gonna keep going. Maybe this will be an hour video. 7 hours, we'll see. So these things I can just tell are getting a little smaller as we go. A little shorter to make the lower half look like it's rotating back in space. Why do I keep coming back here? I'm crazy obsessed with this area. All right, this is getting too big, I think. Let's count through that space. This is one, you've probably seen this in the other videos I've done on blocking. It's such an interesting, important part, I should say, or area you should count through space. What is the real space between here and where that hair is? This is way too big of a chasm. Early block in line. I'm not gonna be too hard on myself. But if you really are just sort of locking into the scale here and you're like, this is this wide, this is this wide, this is this wide, this, where do you want a touchdown? Watch me do this. Where do you want my pencil to stop? Certainly, oh, that just feels way too far. Let's do that again. Right there. That's just in relationship, just visually. I want that curl to be right there. Do that same thing. Hover over a distance and be like, this feels too wide. That feels too wide. Let it develop out of that. I think we're too like over like this. This. No marks. I'm not doing anything. Feel the pencil just sort of magnetically drop down when it feels like it's close to where it needs to be. There we go. I like it. I'm very unsure there, which is why I'm kind of going over here. I'm redirecting because I'm more confident about locking this in, and I feel like I'm going to do better with that. Obviously, it's too big. And I feel like I'm going to do better with that if I resolve some of this more. Namely, let's figure out where this cast shadow is. Let's put a nice happy value in there. Happy value, happy trees. I want to be more like Bob Ross. I say that without irony, you know. I feel like Bob Ross is one of those people that it's sort of ironic to like him, you know, and be like, I like Bob Ross. No, I really do. But he was literally one of the biggest inspirations to me growing up. I used to rush home. I tell this story all the time, but I used to rush home from the school bus when I was in middle school and high school. Look at this. This is a cap eraser from one of my kids. One of my kids was down here doing schoolwork and left me this pencil. And now I dropped it. Get back here. I stole this little cap eraser off this pencil because I can't erase this line with my kneaded eraser. And look at that. CVS brand cap eraser saves the day. Well done. I don't even know what I was saying before. What was I saying? Oh, Bob Ross. I used to rush home from the school bus, get two scoops of vanilla ice cream, chocolate syrup, and watch Bob Ross. And that honestly was just really what made me, you know, I saw paintings about history I love, but that was what made me think of painting as magic. Yeah, as I start to kind of coordinate these new locations here, everything kind of makes sense. This moved about that much, this moved about that much, and this moves about that much. So they were well related before to one another, but they weren't related as well as they could be to the whole. The good news is I don't think this really changes my tentative measurement there that was comparing this to this. I don't think that really changes that. I mean, I'll be aware, I'm going to try to remain aware that, you know, that's something I ought to double check again, but. And then this is the main, even though there's that double light, this is the main shadow here that comes across right here. So do you see that double shadow right there? Let's pretend that's not there, and let's just pretend this is compressed with that. It comes down around the neck. Sorry, I didn't realize how confusing. I haven't looked at this reference in years, at least 2 or 3 years, so I didn't realize that there was a double light there. But I think we can work through it. If you have any questions about that, if you wanted to send me an image of this reference that, you know, with some question marks and want my opinion on what is what in terms of lighting, I'm happy to do that. That ear still seems huge. Urgh. All right, I'm just gonna nudge it up here. I don't usually like to just change things on impulse like that. I'm giving in to pressure. Can't handle it. I'm gonna blame you guys because you're watching. If I was by myself, I would probably be fine, but so every now and then I'm just completely aware that other people are seeing this and I collapse in on myself. So I'm kidding, I don't blame you. I love that you guys are supporting me in these videos, this Patreon channel rather, supporting me on here, because I'm having a lot of fun making videos like this. It's very refreshing. I fully admit I enjoy doing this much more than scripting something out. I feel like I can talk through ideas a lot better. So anyway, sorry, I just want to be clear. I'm absolutely grateful that you all support these videos and support this channel, so thank you. Okay, let's go up here again. Let's compare this height. Can you see this? Let me zoom back out a little bit. Let's compare let's measure this on the reference, just up here to about right there on the chin, and then compare that to a height on the face. All right, so this roughly, I didn't measure it as many times as I should just to keep things faster here. So measure it over and over again. That should equal about right here. Perfect. Not perfect, but good enough. Good enough. I'm feeling good about it. I'm also feeling the crunch of time here. So I want to actually leave this alone right now and hone in more on the face for this video here. What are we at? We're at about 39 minutes of drawing, 41 minutes into the video about. So let's erase this back again. Give it another 10-minute consideration, and then we're going to call this done for this installment, and I plan on coming right back to this one after I get a little bit of a break from it with fresh eyes and see what we can do. I apologize if I get in the way here at all, but I'm kind of feeling a little bit like I need to square myself positionally with the drawing here and potentially lean in a little bit more than I am. So if I get in the way, I'm so sorry. All right, let's get in there. I'm gonna go back more towards line. Let me zoom in a little bit more here for you. How's that? Okay. I'm gonna go back to more line compared to tone. I'm gonna get a little bit more conceptual and treat these more as rounded lines. Now we can just barely see that far eyelid, which is kind of cool. I can describe this moment now, or these moments now, as being very sculptural. I really feel like I'm shaping clay now. So I am stepping into that more conceptual three-dimensional mode right now. I underplayed the break in the nose right there. And now I'm kind of going back in and putting it more because my tendency in the past was to over tilt that. So I felt myself kind of erring towards treating it smoother and then going in and adding more because of that tendency. So everyone's different. I can't know whether or not you're someone who's more likely to over tilt things or under tilt things, but very often I'm trying to do the opposite of what I normally do and err on that other side so that I can minimize those propensities. It's all looking good right there. Here's that far eyebrow. We can't really see it that much, but I know it's over around there. So I'm kind of coordinating on an axis to this one. Now I get to work in this area again and not feel bad about it because I'm supposed to be here right now. Very hard to work on a tilt like this. Thinking about that as a form now helps me see this in a much more understandable way. Okay, Notice how this cast shadow right here inside this doesn't come down as there's this space here where the eyelid meets the eyelashes, or the eyelashes come from that, and there's a space here where the shadow intersects a little higher on that. This is still too high to me. See, even though that's too far. So I really want to kind of get the nose up a little higher, believe it or not, even though I was aware of that early on, still bugging me. Nostril wing should be about right there. That should curve up to the nostril hole being right about there. Yep, it has to go up a little bit. You can see how long it takes me to get to actually moving it. It's like, if you've sort of tracked this video, there's hunches I have along the way, senses I develop of where things ought to be. And that's very different than when I actually, you know, go into action and move them. And oddly enough, I don't think the bottom has to move all that much, despite the fact that I nudged that stuff up a little bit. The septum needs to fill out a little bit more there. See this peak right here, the upper lip, right there where the philtrum connects? Look for that and then see how it coordinates to the same counterpart on the contour right there. There's a little point on the contour, and then you get this very blunt plane here going down the tubercle, and then we get the tubercle going in like that. All right, feeling pretty good about that, I guess, for now. Tell me what you all like. Do you like working more with the shapes, or do you like working with the tone? Or do you like this sort of interplay where we did line, then we did a kind of a second pass with tone, and now we're going back to the line? Even though I'm putting some of the tone back in, the emphasis is back on the line. I'd just be interested to hear what sort of resonates most with you all. Rather than stopping here and treating this as a flat shape, let's follow this more conceptually as a jawline and form here. I think that's, to be perfectly honest, part of the reason why I'm feeling so insecure about the ear, is that I was looking at this as a sort of flat shape and not following this as a three-dimensional form back here. So some things just are hard to solve in a shape mode and require a certain degree of conceptualization or three-dimensional consideration. I'm pretty happy with this. lilac. I can't even see those because of the hair there, but just feel like it'll look cool. More 3D. Cannot see the anti-tragus there. So I see the tragus is pretty easy to lock into right here. That's that flap right here over the auditory canal or hole or whatever. And then you have the anti-tragus right here, but it's not very, I keep wanting to make it bulge out based on what I think an ear form ought to look like there. And I can't quite see it at this angle with the hair, and it may be that it's not that prominent here in this situation. Let's put some of the hair in right here, and I think we're pretty close to calling it a day on this one. I want to be relatively minimal on these indications here, because it's not actual true shadow. I don't want to get too caught up in modeling, but I do want to consider that space in there a little bit. So I'm feeling pretty good about this, honestly. It'll be interesting to see how I feel when I get a little bit of distance. And I do think the body is going to come up a little bit higher, because I did, I don't know if you caught this, I didn't narrate it, but I nudged these up a little bit more as I sort of solidified that this came up. So I could see it going up another lines with or two. But I'll tell you what, next time we come back to this, which I'll do, you know, in a couple days later this week, maybe get that posted early next week, I will start by measuring and just sort of see sort of how things add up in that more objective way, and then come up with a plan. Also sort of list out my feelings about it after that break. I'm going to wait another day or two before I come back to it and just sort of go through with you all, you know, what I see, kind of self-critique. I think self-critique is very important, so I'll try to set a good example for that as best I can, and then take some measurements and then try to come up with a rational way to finish it out. Now, I think that the next session we can actually finish this. I don't think it's going to take three sessions to finish this drawing. So I'd like to finish it. If it's not horrible, I think it's going to be fine. I want to transfer it to tone paper and do a nice tone drawing from start to finish with you all here on Patreon. So let me know if you have any comments, any questions. I'm going to leave it here for now. And yeah, if you bring any questions up here in the next day or two and catch me before I film the next video, perhaps I can include that in the next video. If not, I will leave my responses in the comments below. So thanks for watching, and I'll talk to you guys soon. Bye.